Hey guys, and a very warm welcome back to my channel. So I welcome you to our bilateral relationship series, and we have already covered lots and lots of topics for this bilateral relations, and this is a probably last topic that we are going to cover because we have completed all of the topics and we have covered all of the neighboring countries. If there would be any of the country left which is of importance, so I will cover that also, don't worry. So I welcome you back to this power-packed video, and this is the free UPSC preparation by Avan Onjo. This is the channel, and we'll be preparing for prelims and mains along with maps. Everything that I'm going to explain you which needs map, I'm going to use them also, okay? And I would like all of you to like and subscribe to this channel and share it with your friends who need it. Okay, so this is completely free for all of you. You don't have to pay anything. I'm just asking you to subscribe this channel, so please do this. This gives us motivation to prepare more videos. So without any further delay, let's begin. So we will be talking about India-Pakistan relations in this particular video. So now let's begin. So we all know that we have one of the most troublesome relations with Pakistan. So let me change the ink color so that it's more visible. Okay, so it is one of the most troubled relationship between India and Pakistan. So why is this a troubled relationship? Why there is so much difference in our ideologies? Okay, so the thing is that we have different philosophies and different perspective of nation building. First of all, India, let's talk about what is our philosophy. So India believes in unity in diversity. Unity in diversity. Okay, whereas Pakistan believes in two nation theory. So what is this two nation theory? So this two nation theory is that, you know, the two nation here refers to India and Pakistan. And India and Pakistan cannot coexist together. This is their theory. Why? Because Pakistan is majority Islam and India is majority Hindu. And they say that religion is the only factor that is going to bind a nation together. If we are living together in one country with different religion, so we wouldn't be able to coexist peacefully. This is what their philosophy is. So according to them, religion is the binding factor for nation building, and this has been proved wrong when Pakistan and Bangladesh separated. Okay, we will talk about that also, that what how did the separation, we have already talked about the separation of Bangladesh from Pakistan. Earlier it was East and West Pakistan, then East Pakistan separated and became Bangladesh, and India has played a major role in providing independence to Bangladesh. I have already created that video, just check that video out if you wanted to know that how did partition happen and what all was the history, why did it happen, what all happened, and how did India, what was the role of India in that. Okay, so I would like all of you to watch that video. But this two nation theory has been proven wrong. Okay, although both East and West Pakistan, both of them were Islam countries, but then also they separated. Okay, so that means their theory was proven wrong. And India believe in unity in diversity. We all know that India is very diverse country. Okay, and we celebrate and accept our diversity in terms of language, culture, religion, food habits. Okay, and in language, if you want to know, so we have around 1650 dialects. Okay, and we have more than 116 languages in India. So you can see the diversity. It's highly diverse. India is highly diverse, okay? So also there are many, many religions, many different religions that are followed in India, and we accept each other's religion, and there is no separation on the basis of religion or any other things like diversity, language and culture and all, okay? So India is a diverse country, and that's why we have been able to, you know, maintain. And this unit in diversity, the most important thing that has kept us together is, of course, democracy. We'll talk about democracy in very much detail when we'll study polity and governance. But right now, democracy is a binding factor. Our constitution is the binding factor. Okay. So, if constitution wouldn't have been there, then unity and diversity would have been very difficult. Okay. Okay. So, this was all about our philosophies, our differences in philosophies of nation building of India and Pakistan. Okay. Now, I would like to link it to this two nation theory of Pakistan, okay, and why they claim Jammu and Kashmir. Jammu and Kashmir is a very sensitive topic, and Jammu and Kashmir, the Pakistan claims Jammu and Kashmir, why? Because they believe in their two nation theory. Okay, again, two nation theory is at work here. They say that Jammu and Kashmir is a Muslim majority. Okay, so that's why it should be under Pakistan. But India believes unity in diversity. We have never said that if it is a Muslim majority country, so it cannot be in India. We have a philosophy of unity in diversity. Unity in diversity. So, of course, we have a very, very different point of view. And there are lots and lots of disputes in Jammu and Kashmir. We are going to discuss that also. We are going to discuss Article 370 also, which has been removed on 5th of August 2019. We'll talk about that also, okay, in detail. We'll talk about that, was it democratically correct or not? And you can, of course, give your own opinion, but I'll share my opinion on that issue also. So we'll talk about every possible disputes that are there and whatever agreements that have been there till now. Okay. Also, I would like to tell you that Jammu and Kashmir, okay, when there was partition, after partition, Jammu and Kashmir was ruled by a king. Okay, and the king signed the instrument of accession. Okay, it is known as instrument of accession was signed by the king of Jammu and Kashmir at that point of time. And in that instrument of accession, in the presence of Lord Mountbatten also, this was signed. He has signed that accession also, according to which Jammu and Kashmir has agreed to be a part of Indian Union. Okay, we'll discuss about all of these issues and what is our claim towards Jammu and Kashmir, and we'll discuss everything. Okay. Also, when Pakistan and India separated, okay, then the elections also happened. Okay. And how elections happened, there were certain kind of boxes that were created, okay, and there were white papers that were given to people to select their whichever party they want to vote, and put, you know, there was on the box, there was party's name and a symbol, and they were asked to drop that white paper in whichever party they want to select in that box. So that was the kind, and you can read it in the NCRT of class 12th also, it is given. You can read it there, how the elections were conducted for the first time, and it was a very, very troublesome process, but still we are able to manage that. And then the government of Congress came into power with Jawaharlal Nehru as the Prime Minister. So you can just have a look at that also. Also, I would like to cover a tangent of Cold War. Immediately after India and Pakistan got separated, then Cold War era came, okay, which was between the two power block, US and USSR. Okay, we have discussed this earlier as well. So Pakistan was an ally of US and India was somewhere closer to USSR, although we followed a non-alignment theory. But after some time, after when Indira Gandhi came to power, we have signed certain agreements of friendship with USSR. So it clearly showed that we are more aligned towards USSR, and Pakistan was more aligned towards US. So this also created a divergence between both the countries. Okay, this can also be a reason. Okay, and of course, terrorism is another very, very serious issue. And terrorism is very much practiced by Pakistan. Okay, terrorism is considered as a proxy war. Why? Because it is not a war, it is a very, very low cost kind of an alternative to war, and also it is a kind of a war where people are killed, but still it is not a complete real war. It is kind of a proxy war with a low cost. Okay, and they send the terrorists to India, and they create havoc and kill people. So terrorism is highly based on orthodoxism. Orthodoxism, and it is also based on fundamentalism. So it is a kind of a proxy war which is being practiced by Pakistan. And how did Pakistan why Pakistan knows more about terrorism, and they knew that this could only the way to fight against India in some way and create some disputes. So because we have read when we talked about India and Afghanistan, where Pakistan and US, they produced Talibans. Okay, if you remember, we have talked about it. Okay, so this said that these are the terrorist group. Okay, so from there only Pakistan knows that how this terrorism works, and hence they are using terrorism in their their foreign affairs also. Okay, now let us start with a very, very important topic, that why Jammu and Kashmir is integral part of India. Why Jammu and Kashmir is integral part of India? Okay, why Jammu and Kashmir belongs to India? I would like to make points here. We know already the theory on which Pakistan claims Jammu and Kashmir, but in reality, Jammu and Kashmir has been under India only. It was and it will be under India only. It was, it is, and it will be. So how? Let us discuss here. So first of all, Jammu and Kashmir was formed in 1846. Okay, it is formed in 1846 by the Treaty of Amritsar. You have to remember this, okay? Treaty of Amritsar between Raja Gulab Singh and Britishers. Raja Gulab Singh B, okay? Raja Gulab Singh. Okay, so this was signed by Raja Gulab Singh and Kashmir was formed. Then after independence, it was ruled by Maharaja. Let me write Maharaja also. Maharaja Hari Singh. Okay, Maharaja Hari Singh was the ruler of Jammu and Kashmir at that point of time, and it was a kind of an independent state with a Maharaja ruling, and it is autonomous. Okay, then India gained independence, and all the countries that were under British India, they were divided accordingly to the borders and areas, whereas the other countries which were not under British India, which were autonomous at that point of time, they were asked that whether they wanted to be a part of India or they wanted to be a part of Pakistan. Okay, so Jammu and Kashmir was also the one which was asked. Okay, But Maharaja Hari Singh at that point of time, he didn't want it to be under any of the any of the countries, not either towards Pakistan and not even towards India, and he wanted to maintain his independence. So he signed a standstill agreement, means standstill agreement. It was signed by Hari Singh and Pakistan. Okay. Because Pakistan was getting very impatient. Okay, so he signed a standstill agreement where he said that I'm right now not going to give any kind of verdict and I need some time. Okay, so it is like a standstill for that country. Okay, not country, state, sorry. So it was a standstill for that. Okay, and till the time standstill agreement was there, Pakistan was starting to lose its patience. Okay, and after they lost all of their patience, what they did is that they attacked Jammu and Kashmir, and that was the move which has led ultimately Jammu and Kashmir to be a part of India. They attacked Jammu and Kashmir. Attacked Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, Pakistan attacked where mostly it was their troops, Pakistani troops, plus their tribal communities. They together attacked Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, now they were literally killing people. Whoever came into their way. Within 5 days, they reached from Pakistan to, they reached Baramulla in Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, so when Maharaja Hari Singh got to know that they are coming very closer and they are killing people, thousands and thousands of people were killed, and they were literally mercilessly killing everyone whoever came into their way. And when so Maharaja Hari Singh, you know, he got scared, and it was only two options that was left with him. One being that he would let Pakistan attack and does not do anything, you know, be there and let Pakistan attack and destroy Jammu and Kashmir, and the other would be to negotiate with India. So he chose the second option, to negotiate with India. Okay, so he went to India and asked our Prime Minister, Deputy Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru and Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. He asked that Indian troops should be sent there in order to protect Jammu and Kashmir, but Jawaharlal Nehru and Patel said that it could only happen, we could only send our troops only to Indian territory. Okay, so you are not in Indian territory currently, so if you want us to send our support to your Jammu and Kashmir, then you should be a part of Indian Union. This was the condition that was left, because of course we cannot send, okay, to another territory, so that was needed. So hence finally Maharaja signed the instrument of accession. Okay, but there were certain conditions. Okay, Maharaja wanted to have a maximum autonomy. He wanted to have a maximum autonomy, and we agreed for that. We agreed to give them maximum autonomy, and we only needed three things, that is defense, external affairs and communication. These were the three things. Communication. Okay, these were the three things that were asked by India to be given to India, and rest everything is autonomous with Raja Hari Singh. Okay, so there was an agreement that was signed between the two. Okay, and this was called as instrument of accession. Okay. This was instrument of accession that was signed, where Maharaja Hari Singh agreed to be a part of महाराजा हरि सिंह अग्रीड दैट जम्मू एंड कश्मीर शुड बी पार्ट ऑफ इंडिया. ओके, बट पाकिस्तान रिफ्यूज दिस इंस्ट्रूमेंट ऑफ एक्सेशन एंड इट वॉज इंटरनेशनल एक्सेशन. इट इज़ वेरी वैलिड एंड इट वॉज साइंड अंडर देन गवर्नर लॉर्ड माउंट बैटन. ही वॉज ऑल्सो देयर. ओके, हिज साइंस आर ऑल्सो देयर. सो वी कैन से दैट यू नो इट इज़ अ वेरी मच वैलिड एंड वेरी काइंड ऑफ इंटरनेशनल एक्सेशन दैट वॉज देयर. बट पाकिस्तान ऑफकोर्स refused that instrument. Okay, and the war continued from 1947 to 1949. War continued. Okay, so the war went for around 1 year 2 months and 2 weeks. This was the duration of war. Okay. Finally, there was a ceasefire agreement, US, in which US intervened, and we signed a ceasefire agreement. Ceasefire agreement was signed. UN, United Nations was, you know, ceasefire agreement. So, United Nations was approached by India. Agreement. Okay, United Nation was India initiated the meeting with United Nation in order to, you know, have some kind of solution for this war. And at that time, US came up with the ceasefire agreement where they said that for Jammu and Kashmir, related to the dispute of Jammu and Kashmir, they said that the decision of ceasefire was taken by UNSC, that is United Nations Security Council. Okay, and it was decided by the committee that which was headed by Lord Mountbatten. This committee was headed by Lord Mountbatten. Okay, and PM Nehru was the only member. Britishers were in hurry to stop this war and go back to their nation, so they asked for three things. It was in around 1948 when this resolution was presented, okay, and it was signed by both also. So first thing that was there was that there should be a withdrawal of troops first of all by Pakistan, okay, from POK. Okay, secondly, there should be a reduction in troops by India. When Pakistan withdraws the troop, then the reduction of troops by India would be done by India. And thirdly, after which the plebiscite would be conducted, because Pakistan was demanding plebiscite, and Jawaharlal Nehru also agreed for that, because Jawaharlal Nehru was very sure that the people of Jammu and Kashmir wanted to be a part of Indian Union, because actually people wanted to be a part of Indian Union. They have been in India for the longest time, they have lived there, they are very comfortable here, and they were not some orthodoxist kind of a Muslim community, so they were very very okay with being a part of Indian Union. And they also, if they were asked to choose from Pakistan and India, then they were very much, majority of them wanted to be a part of India. Okay, so Jawaharlal Nehru was very very positive about this, and he also agreed to conduct a plebiscite. But for the plebiscite to happen, these two conditions should be fulfilled for the firstly, and then only plebiscite could happen. And the first ever, the first point itself is that Pakistan should remove their withdraw their troops, which never happened. Pakistan would never withdraw their troops, okay, and hence plebiscite also never happened for Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, so these were the conditions, and there should be a ceasefire. It was also decided that both Pakistan and India army were asked to have a ceasefire, and wherever the army is on both the sides, okay, that would be concluded to be a LOC that we are going to see in the agreement, Shimla agreement that was signed. Okay, where the ceasefire line was converted into line of control, we'll see that also. Okay, so what were the reasons that why did we agree for a ceasefire? That is also a point. Okay, ceasefire, why did we agree in 1949? So the thing is that, of course, both the Pakistani army and the Indian army, both of them were headed by British officers, and if there would be a war between India and Pakistan, then who would be at the war? British versus British. Britishers would be at the war with themselves, which they don't want. Secondly, they are in a hurry to leave India and Pakistan and go back to their nation, okay, because independence have been provided. So they were hurrying a lot, okay, so they are not ready, and they don't even want to have another battle or another war. They don't want to be a part of it. Okay. So, also United Nations, there is a great faith of Nehru in United Nations, and of course that's why we also agreed for ceasefire, because we believed in them, we believed in United Nations. So you can say these 2-3 reasons is why we agreed for ceasefire. Okay, so what are our arguments related to the fact, arguments of Jammu and Kashmir being integral part of India, related to Jammu and Kashmir, okay, being an integral part of India. First of all, Maharaja Hari Singh signed the instrument of accession with India. Secondly, okay, the partition on the basis of two nation theory was only applied to the British India, okay, and all the other places which were independent, they were asked for their own opinion, okay, and they were given the freedom to either be a part of India or Pakistan, and Jammu and Kashmir agreed to be a part of Indian Union. Okay, after doing everything also, there was a very very prominent and a popular leader whose name was Sheikh Abdullah of Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, and he is a very popular leader. He is being listened to, and by the whole, whatever he says, Jammu and Kashmir agrees upon that, because he was a very very well known and a popular leader there. Okay, and Sheikh Abdullah was also supporting India. So if they would be asked, then Sheikh Abdullah would also have said that he wanted the Jammu and Kashmir wanted to be a part of India. So Sheikh Abdullah supported India. Okay. Also, they were not, I already told this point, that they were Sufi Islamists there who live in Pakistan. Okay, at that point of time. In Jammu and Kashmir. Sufi Islamists are there, which they don't believe in two nation theory and all, and they don't believe in this fundamentalism. Also, we agreed for a plebiscite, but that never happened, because I already told you the first two points needs to be fulfilled before plebiscite could take place. Okay. So this was our arguments, and they are very 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 much valid. Okay, so I would like to talk about one more event, that is in 1951. Okay, in 1951, UNCIP mandate was terminated, and there was another mandate that was formed. Okay, according to which there would be a United Nation military observer. I've improved my writing, I suppose, with a mouse, or maybe even only I feel that, I don't know, but I feel it. Okay, so there is a United Nation military observer, okay, group, okay, in India and Pakistan, MOGIP, and they are the observer that if the line of siege is maintained or not, LOC is maintained or not, okay, ceasefire is maintained or not. So they are observer of that, and they're still there, still they observe it, okay. Then I was talking about the Shimla agreement, okay. So in 1972 there was an agreement, okay, which is signed between India and Pakistan, according to which the ceasefire line which we agreed upon would be the line of control between India and Pakistan, and it was agreed that no one shall violate this line and LOC is the final line, okay, according to which 1/3 of Jammu and Kashmir is with Pakistan currently, okay, line of control. So 1/3 of Jammu and Kashmir is with Pakistan right now. So now let us discuss another important topic, that is Article 370. Okay, so according to this article, when the autonomy was given to Jammu and Kashmir, so this article is actually the article which provides autonomy to Jammu and Kashmir except for defense, communication and external affairs. So otherwise the autonomy is given to Jammu and Kashmir, and this article is the special provision in constitution. This article has been written as a special provision and special status. This article provides a special status to Jammu and Kashmir, okay, which was negotiated during the entry of Jammu and Kashmir into Indian Union. In 1951, Constituent Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir was made. Okay. For drafting constitution, and in 1956 finally they formed a constitution of Jammu and Kashmir was made. So they have a different constitution, they don't follow Indian constitution, just the defense, communication and external affairs comes into the power of India. Otherwise everything else is autonomous for Jammu and Kashmir, and they have their own constitution as well, okay. But in Article 352 of Indian Constitution, it has been said that in the case of national emergency, this article could be withdrawn for some time till the time there is national emergency, but this article cannot be extended to the internal armed rebellion of rebellion in Jammu and Kashmir, okay. So this was a provision. Now, you would have heard in the news that on 5th of August, this would have become a historic day, okay. This has become a historic day, 2019, you could remember this day. 5th of August 2019, this Article 370 was withdrawn, okay. And Jammu and Kashmir has been provided the status of a union territory, and Ladakh has been separated as another union territory from Jammu and Kashmir. So this was the provision that was passed on 5th of August 2019 by both the Houses of Parliament, and it has been implemented now, okay. So that was a thing. We will create a separate video on how Article 370 was withdrawn, okay, what all happened, what was the process, how it was all, you know, took place. So we'll talk about that, because that's a very big topic in itself. Okay. So that's the thing. Right now, let me talk about 1965 war between, this is the next topic, okay? 1965 war between Pakistan and India, okay? Which was, the dispute was related to Sir Creek region, Sir Creek boundary dispute. Sir Creek region. Okay, I will show this to you on a map. Okay, so I hope you guys can see this map. This map very well tells about the Sir Creek dispute. Okay, so if you guys look at this map carefully, so first of all, let me draw the distinction. This is the Pakistan, green colored area has been depicted by Pakistan, and this red color area has been depicted by India. Okay, so as you guys can see, this is the Gujarat area of India, okay, and this is the Sindh region of Pakistan. So here in the Gujarat area, there is this Ran of Kutch. Ran of Kutch is a marshy land, okay. So this is all the marshy area of Gujarat, and a little bit extends to Sindh part also, marshy area, but most of the marshy area here is on Gujarat, and this is known as Ran of Kutch. Now, just a minute. Now you guys can see this particular creek, okay. This creek, a narrow creek, meaning of creek is a narrow, you know, a narrow place where, you know what, a very very narrow place where water is there, okay. So this is a very narrow area where water is there from Arabian Sea. So this particular area, this area, this creek is in the dispute. If you guys can see here, this purple colored line is the boundary that is claimed by Pakistan. That means Pakistan claimed that this is the boundary between India and Pakistan, and hence Sir Creek region should be a part of Pakistan. But what India claims is that there should be a central kind of boundary, okay. India is not claiming the entire creek, but it is claiming the central point of this boundary, and this red colored dotted line is what is claimed, what is you know, boundary that is claimed by India. Okay, so this is the issued, this is the disputed area here, this Sir Creek. Now you guys can see this L-shaped line also. Okay, so this earlier, this line was also not marked between India and Pakistan. So there was a tribunal, this has been written here also. Okay, so there was a tribunal of 1968. In 1968, there was a tribunal, and the verdict of this tribunal came regarding this L-shaped line, which marked the border between India and Pakistan. But this region, the dispute between this region was still not resolved. Okay, they didn't mark the boundary of Sir Creek region. So this is the disputed region because of which 1965 war took place. 1965 war took place because of this Sir Creek region. I hope this is clear to you all. Now let us talk about this 1965 war. Okay, so Pakistan claims around 9100 square feet. I told you already, I showed you the boundary, square kilometer of area of Sir Creek, okay, is claimed by Pakistan. Also, Sir Creek is also known as Ban Ganga. Okay, so if there is word Ban Ganga, you should not get worried about that. What is it? Okay, this is also known as Ban Ganga. So you need to remember this. So how did the war begin? In 1965 itself, Pakistan started patrolling certain areas of Ban Ganga, okay, and which India claim is ours, okay, India's claim, and they started to patrol somewhere in the area which is claimed by India. Pakistan started patrolling there, okay. So this basically began after that, okay. There were certain fights then between India and Pakistan, and ultimately this led to killing of many many Indian soldiers. We will study also that why our army was not prepared for this particular war. We'll discuss all the circumstances that were there. Okay, so there were certain wars. The war fighting happened in 1965. Then when the war was there, British PM intervened. PM Harold intervened. Okay, PM Harold in Harold Wilson was his full name. So he intervened and he said that there should be a tribunal for the verdict for the disputed area. There should be a tribunal that should be set up to reserve the areas of India and Pakistan. And in 1968 the tribunal gave the verdict. In 1968 tribunal gave the verdict and tribunal demarcated this L-shaped line. Okay, this L-shaped line that we talked about, this was demarcated by tribunal, but still Sir Creek region was not yet marked. Okay, so this is the case. Now let me tell you the circumstances which led to 1965 war as something that India was India felt very difficult to tackle with. Why? Because first of all, in 1962 there was India-China war already that happened. India-China war that was happening, and India was not prepared for this war in 1965. Okay, it demoralized army because they were not prepared and they were suddenly attacked by Pakistan. It demoralized army and also led to killing of many of the Indian soldiers. Okay, this war also devastated our economy. We were facing droughts and famine conditions. Also, in 1964, Nehru died. Okay, you know about this war I'm talking about, na? Which Mao attacked India suddenly, even after signing the Panchsheel. That was this war, okay? Then Nehru also died after experts say that he was not well from the time when there was India-China war, because he didn't thought that China would break the promise of Panchsheel and would attack India. It highly affected Nehru because he was very critical about foreign policy and external issues, and this highly affected Nehru, and in turn in around 1964 he died. Okay, experts say that this is one of the reason for his death. Okay, then 1965 was a major opportunity for Pakistan to attack India. They saw this as an opportunity. Then Lal Bahadur Shastri came to power after Nehru. Lal Bahadur Shastri came to power, but he was not considered to be that strong of a leader, so they were not that fearful. Also, our military somewhere is less modernized. Military was less modernized in some way. Modern techniques always provide a benefit. Okay, our Indian Army is very capable, but some modernization needed to happen, which was very slow. It was a slow modernization that we were facing as an issue. Pakistan was under the rule of General Ayub Khan. Ayub Khan, of course, under military rule. Ayub Khan was a general. I'll write here General Ayub Khan. Pakistan was under General Ayub Khan, and he was a strong leader. So he took this step. Strong leader. Okay. Also, there was a fear of Chinese attack. We just came out of the war. Chinese attack was also very, very unpredictable that happened. Okay. It has exhausted our army also. So hence, this all led us to face a setback in Kutch region in April, in the war of April 1965. Okay, so these were all the reasons. I hope all the reasons are pretty much clear to you. I explained very clearly everything. Now let us talk about what actually happened in the war of 1965. Okay, so in August 1965, Pakistan launched an operation called Operation Gibraltar. I hope spelling are Gibraltar. Okay. The ceasefire line was porous. Ceasefire line between India and Pakistan was porous. They entered into India. They infiltrated, into Jammu and Kashmir. Around 26,000 soldiers, 26,000 to around 33,000 soldiers of Pakistan entered India. Okay. They entered India and they disguised themselves as locals. They entered Jammu and Kashmir to create a kind of an internal unrest in the people of Jammu and Kashmir, so that in order to literally brainwash them to revolt against India. Okay, this was their intention. But certain Jammu and Kashmir locals, they got to know about this infiltration and they informed the Indian army about the same. The Kashmiri population, they informed the Indian army immediately, and the people of Jammu and Kashmir also didn't cooperate with those Pakistani people. So that is the beauty that tells that, of course, they are an integral part of India by heart also. Okay, so they immediately informed the Indian army, as well as they didn't cooperate with them. So this somehow failed their mission, original mission of Gibraltar. Okay, when Pakistan got to know that their plan is moving towards a failure, then they started moving towards south of LOC. They started moving towards south of LOC along the international border, across the Akhnoor region, Akhnoor region of Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, and this is the second mission that they started then, okay, after the failure of this first mission. The second mission is known as Operation Grand Slam. Operation Grand Slam. Okay, and this was Operation Gibraltar. Okay, so this particular region, Akhnoor region, has a geographical advantage for Pakistan, so they started to cross the LOC from there. Okay, so they planned to stop Indian army at that point only. Okay, and they wanted to cut off Jammu and Kashmir from India. Okay, so I'll give you a timeline. On 5th of August, there was a Gibraltar operation that happened. Then in around 15th of August, there was Indian troop. Sorry, Pakistani troops. The in Pakistan is infiltrated India. Okay, then in around 1st of September, there was their second operation, that was Operation Grand Slam, that started. Okay, then in around 6th of September, this could be said as the beginning of the war. Okay, Indian army, when they got to know that they are moving from in the Akhnoor region, Indian army started to move south, and they moved further south towards Pakistan. Okay, from Punjab. Okay, and Indian army started to march towards Lahore of Pakistan. If they are infiltrating, so we also started to infiltrate. Okay, there was a very big miscommunication that happened, which could be planned. Okay, so there was this miscommunication that happened when our then Prime Minister Bahadur Shastri was informed. Okay, and he was informed that our army is running short of ammunition. Okay, and because of this, Bahadur came to action and he informed, this was a miscommunication that happened. Then Lal Bahadur Shastri got informed about them, that international communities got involved. International communities got involved on 22nd September 1965. They got involved by UN. UN got involved. Okay. And they unanimously passed the agreement of ceasefire. Okay. Then finally on 23rd of September, ceasefire was agreed. So you can see this miscommunication led to the involvement of UN. There was a unanimous agreement that was passed for ceasefire, and on 23rd September ceasefire was declared by India. Okay, then there was a meeting which was mediated by USSR between India and Pakistan. Okay, on 4th January 1966 in Tashkent area. In Tashkent, okay, this is also known as Tashkent meeting, and there was a Tashkent agreement that was there. Tashkent agreement, okay, and according to that, both Pakistan and India agreed to withdraw on pre 5th August 1965 line. We agreed to withdraw, both agreed to withdraw. And on that night itself, on the same night when Tashkent agreement happened, लाल बहादुर शास्त्री ऑल्सो डाइड ऑन द सेम नाइट. ओके सो हिज कॉज फॉर दैट वॉज हार्ट अटैक. सो वॉट वॉज द लेसन लर्न फ्रॉम ताशकेंट. ओके एनी थर्ड पार्टी मीडिएटर कुड बी काउंटर प्रोडक्टेड. ऑल्सो आफ्टर ताशकेंट रिलेशन वी मेड क्लियर that there is a lack of interest for a third party mediator. There is no decisive victory for Pakistan in 1965, and no war pact with Pakistan was also not signed. Okay, so that is all about 1965 war. Phir next war happened in 1971. Next war happened in 1971, which was Bangladesh Liberation War. Bangladesh Liberation War. Okay. The issue of Bangladesh, of course, started internally into Pakistan. People of East Pakistan felt that they were not given their due space, which is their right, and they were not given a fair share. Okay. Although East Pakistan has more population, more fertile land, still they were overlooked by the West Pakistanis. Okay. Also, their location was near Bengal. Okay. So they have a culture difference between West Pakistan and East Pakistan. They East Pakistanis usually had the Bengalis culture. Okay. They have a very much similarity. From Bengali culture of India, so they were not very much linked to each other. Okay, also geographically, also they were at a very, you know, India is in between both of them, so it was a big area there separated by a big space. Okay, so all of these issues and all of other factors led to separation of Bangladesh, separation of East Pakistan, as to say. In the form of Bangladesh from West Pakistan, which is now only Pakistan, and that East Pakistan which separated is now called Bangladesh. Okay. So you all know the story about Awami League, which I discussed in detail in my India Bangladesh bilateral issues topic. On that video, you can just watch that video to know about how all separation happened and what was, you know, how all war was created. So there was a war, okay, and India had to intervene. So there was a Shimla agreement that was signed. In 1972, where it was asked that first of all Pakistan should recognize the Bangladesh as independent Bangladesh. Pakistan should recognize Bangladesh as independent. Secondly, Pakistan agreed to release political prisoners. Like Sheikh Abdullah. Okay. So Sheikh Abdullah was also released, and in turn India agreed to release all the prisoners of war of Pakistan. India agreed to release all the prisoners of war of Pakistan. Okay. Although India was not ready to release them, but it has to be done because Pakistan also agreed. Okay, so it was a mutual agreement between both of us that you release the political leaders of Bangladesh and we will release the prisoners of war of Pakistan. Okay, so it was a mutual decision. Then thirdly, both of the side agreed to resolve our disputes bilaterally and peacefully. Peaceful resolution of the disputes. Also, Jammu and Kashmir LOC was also talked about, and we made a statement of line of control of Jammu and Kashmir, and we said that the ceasefire line would be called as LOC. The ceasefire line would be called as LOC. Okay, meaning that the both countries agreed that LOC would be the future international border between India and Jammu and Kashmir. Okay, so this all were the agreements that happened in Shimla agreement. Okay, when there was a Bangladesh liberation war. So after that, Bangladesh separated and our LOC was also created. So this was all about the two wars that happened. Now I would like to talk about the issue of Indus Water Treaty. Certain water sharing issues that are there between India and Pakistan, and that I would create another video for that, because we are still left with certain very important topics that needs to be covered. We are also left with a very important topic of CPC that I told you that we'll discuss when we will do India-Pakistan relations. So I will just stop this video because it has already been a long video. I will create a part 2 of this video where we'll talk about the remaining issues between India and Pakistan, and most probably I would be able to complete India-Pakistan in that video itself. Okay, so I hope you liked this video and enjoyed and understood the concepts. And if you did, don't forget to like and subscribe to our channel. This is the only thing I'm asking you to, just subscribe to us. We are not asking you for any fees. We are just asking you to subscribe, like also if you like the video, share it with your friends who need it. Okay, so this is it for today, and stay tuned for upcoming videos. I will make a continuation video of part 2 of India-Pakistan relations. So till then, stay safe and very, very bye.